Ladies and gentlemen, let's begin our last panel. And our first speaker is Olena Martyniuk with her presentation. Tolerance, Reunion of Gardens and Bodies, female optics and art reflecting war in Donbass. Olena Martyniuk is an art historian with an interest in art theory and philosophy. Her research focuses on Ukrainian and Russian art from the late 20th century to the present. She graduated with a PhD in art history from Rutgers University in January 2018. She's a Jacek postdoctoral fellow in Ukrainian studies at the Harriman Institute of Columbia University for 2019-2021. Her dissertation titled Postmodern Perestroika, Ukrainian-Russian Artist Networks of the 1918s, 1919s, examined the work of artists in the last Soviet generation. The Harriman Institute, Dr. Martyniuk will work at the Harriman Institute, Dr. Martyniuk will work further on transforming her dissertation into the book manuscript with attention to the influence of Ukraine's delayed post-colonial emancipation in Ukrainian visual culture of the late 20th century. Her most recent show of Kyiv Perestroika art will open at the Zimmerli Art Museum in spring of 2020. And now her presentation.
I would like to begin by thanking Marko Andrejczyk for organizing this extremely inspirational conference, and for me personally to embark on this sideway but very exciting project about this woman artist dealing with a war in the Donbass. So I would like to start with a short fragment of a song about Donbass. Can you please switch it on? I think we can stop now. Thank you. Thank you so much. So you can later explore the art of this wonderful folk punk band comprised by women musicians from Ukraine. But I included it because I felt like it really encapsulated the perception of Donbass region, which majorly existed before the war in Donbass. On the one hand, we are talking about, like in this photo series by Alexander Chekmenov, in which Donbass appears this cruel and barren land dotted with terracons, these artificial mountains of coal production rubbish and populated with stern miners, their skin permanently marked with coal dust. On the other, this bleak vision is contrasted by the persistent Soviet cliché of Donetsk being the city of million roses. The flowers were planted to implement the dream of the Soviet bureaucrat Vladimir Dегтярев, who once went to Versailles Garden and was so impressed that he decided to implement his dream in his in the city of his jurisdiction. This jarring, almost phantasmagoric contradiction provoked such responses as the sun and resonated with me as I conducted interviews with Ukrainian women artists dealing with the subject of the war in Donbas. The garden as a theme and operational metaphor in describing the horrendous impact of war on society appeared often as we discussed the corrosion of reality, a decay of meaning and symbols, and the war's destabilization of representation as such. In this talk, I would like to address this representational collapse and also question whether there could be a specific female optics on war in the arts. Considering that art that I will be talking about today, neither the performances by Alevtina Kakhidze nor the sculptures by Maria Kulikovska or Anna Zvyagintseva, nor the paintings of Vlada Ralko and Marina Skugareva depict the atrocities of war or testify to the suffering of its victims in an unmediated way. In fact, none of the artworks engage their subjects so obviously that it could be immediately recognized as a war representation. Such rejection of direct visual register in artistic responses to a traumatic and disastrous event like the Donbas War, which has already claimed more than 13,000 of lives, call into question the idea of unrepresentability. Theorized by Jacques Rancière in relation to Holocaust. Attacking François Lyotard's idea of unrepresentability of the sublime, Rancière launched his critique against the impact of the condition he calls the ethical turn, which, I quote, reduced art to the ethnical witnessing of the unrepresentable catastrophe. Instead, Rancière advocated for artistic and political dissensus, and I quote again, a lack of impossibility of representation. I would like to argue that Ukrainian women artists do not perform the silencing of representation, but rather expand the visual field by expressing compassion alone with documenting the regimes of visuality produced by the war. The notion of war as ruin of visual and verbal representation appears in an exchange between Susan Zontag, Virginia Woolf, and Judith Butler, their polyphonic, almost century-long conversation revolving around the possibility of a specifically female voice against, in Zontag words, the perennial seduction of war. Alevtina Kakhidze's ongoing and evolving performance method of conducting political truth was presented for the first time in 2014 on Manifesta, the traveling European Biennial, incidentally taking place in St. Petersburg that year. Already after the Russian annexation of Crimea and its encroachment on Ukraine's east, Kakhidze's performance addressed the destabilization and fragmentation of a subject attempting to comprehend and communicate the violent and traumatic event. During the performance, she embodied the split, the split subjectivity by acting from the perspective of three conceptual characters that she created: the mediator, the tourist, and the fighter against electricity. Taking audience questions such as, whose is Crimea? Or, do you think civilians die from the Ukrainian army's shell fire too? The artist assumed each role by moving in front of the corresponding image and answering from each perspective. The mediator is an akin to international observer. It is someone striving to be above the situation, hear all dissenting perspectives, and alleviate the conflict by all means. the tourist is an innocent bystander who happened to witness and document the event, for instance, by taking photos, but is not familiar with the context of the situation. Meanwhile, the fighter against the electricity is a person highly entrenched in the situation, personally and deeply involved, and skeptical about any information provided by the media. It is important to note here that at the moment, Kahidze's mother was living in a war zone in the city of Zhdanovka in Donetsk region, and which was on a shifting front line, occupied and freed several times during 2014. So when replying to the question about Crimea from the position of the tourist, the artist replied that it was definitely hers, but also belonged to nobody, just like stars. From the point of fighter against electricity, she demanded passionately whether the question about the origin of the shell fire required her mother to leave the safety of her basement, where she was hiding from it, to find out which side was shooting. The figures of Kahidze's drawn characters bear likeness to the artist's appearance and underline that the multiple perspectives can inhabit one person, tearing her apart from within. It is the artist herself simultaneously trying to be objective by answering the tough questions about the war, but often failing by being scared for her mother's life or mentally escaping into the position of a dispassionate tourist. Questioning the idea of truth itself, decaying when confronted with real human suffering, Kahidze's main goals were to enhance empathy and to reveal the manipulation of facts that the hybrid war enabled. When Kahidze presented her performance yet again at the exhibition Revolutionize at Mysetsky Arsenal in Kyiv in December of 2018, it was a result of her four-year work as she repeatedly conducted the performance in her capacity of the UN Ambassador of Tolerance in cities next to the front line. As you see on this slide, a new character appeared, whom the artist herself called a revolutionary experiment, the gardener. Initially, the appearance of the figure was indebted to the refusal of Kahidze's mother to relocate from the war zone, motivated by the impossibility to abandon her garden. While talking to many others near the front line, displaced and forced to relocate many times, the artist discovered that people talked about their gardens a lot. Like in this video, Katerina told the artist that she was forced to leave when the war became especially violent in her native Slovyansk. When the woman returned after the city was taken back by the Ukrainian army, she was dismayed to discover discover her tomatoes lost in a sea of weeds. The woman threw herself to work, cutting and removing wild weed in tears until the late night. When she woke up next morning, she saw that all her tomatoes were on the ground, dead and scorched by the sun. This story allowed the artist to reflect that disturbing the delicate balance in the garden is easy, and the authoritarian rule does not work there. To extrapolate the conclusion further, she decided to give voice to the gardener's perspective. Many questions given to Kahidze before, they were performed by her helpers in the audience. Questions such as, can one throw stones at militia? What was achieved with the help of Maidan? Why discriminate Russian-speaking people in Ukraine? Why do you speak the language of the occupants? And do you think that every Russian guilty in the war? The gardener's answers were the most poetic and paradoxical. When answering to the question, why can't you relocate your mother from the occupied territory, Kahidze, the fighter against the electricity, replied harshly that her mother was not a furniture. And as a gardener, she said that even when replanting a small flower in her garden, she considers it 300 times. Kahidze created a series of drawings she made while talking to her mother over the phone, channeling the fears and frustrations and documenting the stories of Klubnika, of Strawberry Andreevna's life during the war. The artist posted her drawings on the Facebook page that she created for her mother, thus turning her into, I quote, the most well-known senior citizen of the war zone, in the words of Ukrainian journalist Lesya Hanja. Ordinary and fantastic events unfold in the form of a visual diary. Absence of cellular reception forces residents to convene on the local cemetery, the only place which had reception, where they could talk to their relatives and learn how many died in the most recent shelling. Yeah, this image is spectacular. You see both, both the Soviet symbols, the church, like everything is a mix there. The cellars at Klubnika Andreevna, equipped for the shelter, appears on the same page with a diagram depicting the proximity of the place where a neighbor died from the artillery fire, and stray dogs whose owners have left the city. At the local market, the supporters of Ukraine sold the fruits of their gardens next to those voting for Donbass independence in the state referendum. They are drawn intentionally similar by Kahidze. Judith Butler, in her books, Frames of War, posits that the reality of war is not accessible to us beyond the unraveling of the representational regimes through which it operates, for instance, by differentiating the gradability of different lives. Kahidze's drawings emphasize a humanity extending beyond ideological predilections or indoctrinations. The garden is another character in the series, featured often on its own or as a background for stories of war disrupting Klubnika Andreevna's regular chores. The style of Kahidze drawings, not realistic, academic, and sophisticated, but boldly naive, evoking children's manner, inadvertently responds to Susan Zontag's observation about the inauthenticity of the beautiful when it comes to the depiction of war. Kahidze's visualization appear authentic and solicit sincere compassion, especially when knowing that Klubnika Andreevna subsequently died of a heart attack at the checkpoint while crossing to Ukrainian held territory in January 2019. The autobiographical dimension is also present in the sculptures of Maria Kulikovska. The molds of the artist's body have an apparent feminist agenda, while conveying the universal ephemerality and vulnerability of the human condition. Made of soap, a delicate and moldable material, Kulikovska armless body casts recall ancient Greek caryatids, columns shaped as female bodies. With the incommensurability between the fragility of the material and its structural function, Kulikovska contemplates the precarity of woman's position in society, while revealing the female body as a battleground for conflicting ideologies. The artist had not anticipated her work becoming a literal battleground. Installed in the yard of the Cultural Foundation Isolatsiya in Donetsk in 2012, Kulikovska's three sculptures were part of the exhibition Homa Bula, curated by Olena Chervonik, focusing on Rococo-inspired themes of mortality, decay, and transience of human life. By being exposed to the rage of natural elements and time, the sculptures were programmed to manifest the trauma of corporeal presence in the world. Kulikovska documented the sculpture's transformation during her several visits to Donetsk. History intervened when the artist was invited to Izolyatsiya in March of 2014. Her visit coincided with Donetsk Maidan, which began as a peaceful demonstration but quickly escalated into violence. The artist came to support pro-Ukrainian forces which gathered around Taras Shevchenko monument, where she witnessed the demonstration surrounded by a hostile crowd enabled by quickly disappearing local police forces. The crowd started to throw objects at Maidan supporters, and after Kulikovska was hit by rotten eggs several times, she called a taxi to escape, only to be abducted by the taxi driver, who appeared to be a pro-Russian. The man drove the car to the empty field outside of the city, threatening Kulikovska with a gun he claimed he had in his trunk, and which, in his words, was given to him by Russian agents to kill Ukrainians if necessary. After she prepared to part with her life, the driver turned back to the city, bringing the artist back to Donetsk, where she spent a sleepless night before leaving the city for good. The territory of Izolatsia was seized by the militia of the self-proclaimed Donetsk People's Republic several months later, in June 2014, and turned into a prison. Multiple works were recklessly destroyed, while Kulikovska sculptures were used as targets for shooting practice. No trace of a sculptural triptych Homobula remains. Kulikovska continues working in Ukraine and Sweden, banned from and forced to leave her native Crimea, exorcising her traumas with the help of performances and new sculptures. During the same 10th manifesto in St. Petersburg, Kulikovska staged performance 254, which was the number assigned to her refugee petition in Kyiv. Wrapped in a Ukrainian flag, Kulikovska prostrated her body on the stairs of the Hermitage Museum. She was ignored by bystanders for approximately half an hour before a female passerby reported her to the police for disturbing public order. While molding more sculptures after learning of the shooting in Izolatsia, she discovered that the soap had the same exact density as the human body, and thus was used as for tests by military manufacturers. And for her most recent project, titled Hortus Conclusus, Indoor Garden, she utilized professional ballistic soap, defiantly appropriating this role of the shooting target. Hortus Conclus, or an enclosed garden, is a medieval metaphor of a Virgin Mary's innocence. For Kulikovska, her body is the last bastion, her own territory to cultivate and protect flowers not scorched by her experience of war, displacement, and migration. Anna Zvyagintseva's perception of war was not as raw and direct, yet she, similarly to other women artists with whom I communicated, was gripped by an artistic stupor since the deaths on Maidan were followed by the aggression in the East. Incapable of registering her emotions in an aesthetic manner, Zvyagintseva instead went through the folders of her old drawings, noticing that the reality that they depicted was crumbling, the decay spreading across them like some infectious disease. Like many Ukrainian citizens, she was glued to her computer screen, reading news at her desk in front of her window while intently absorbing the familiar, yet somehow radically different landscape outside. This experience developed into her projects of 2015, The Order of Things, which received the Public Choice Prize of the Pinchuk Art Center, and To Draw Your Own Window and Crumple the Paper, which was shown at the School of Kyiv Biennial in 2015. So The Order of Things demonstrated the fragmentation and dissipation of reality inflicted by the trauma of war. The artist rendered her old drawings of women walking with children or picking fruits by welding metal, insisting on the fragility of everyday life by juxtaposing the coarseness of her material to the delicacy of her drawing style. Yet, even the sturdiest of metals cannot withstand the brutality of war. We notice how the contour is broken, and the metallic lines are falling down to create some crude obstruction, a puzzle of fragments, strangely familiar, yet too chaotically dispersed to be assembled back again. In the title of To Draw Your Own Window, To Crumple the Paper, Zvyagintseva reveals the story behind the artwork's appearance as a matter of fact, underlying its principally mundane character nature. The artist is drawing her window with the potted flowers and curtains and disposing the image by crumpling the paper. The anguish and the reason of the gesture is not known. However, and this ambiguity as well as the accidental beauty of the resulting silhouette persists. The sudden sense of loss permits the view as one looks through the crooked window, reminded that nothing stays the same after war marks and smears every habitual object and landscape, turning those who cannot see it still into witnesses and making even flower drawings into something political. Marina Skugareva also shared with me the experience of war-induced caesura in her painting and drawing practices. The Maidan and the war in the East that followed, however, merged into one continuous violent event for her, starting with the first death on Maidan that the artist found impossible to paint. All her previous subjects and concerns seemed worn out by the war and tragedy, yet the war itself could not find its way onto her canvases. Skugareva would spend time in her studio restlessly, admitting to the incongruity of the female nudes or still lives with the crushing news of the Russian advance in the East, tortures, ruinations of cities and bodies. On the matter of war depriving artists of their tools, Susan Zontag quoted the masterful novelist Henry James, facing an unusual lack of words when tasked with describing the destruction of the one World War I battle. The war has used up words. They have weakened. They have deteriorated, end of quote. Ukrainian poet Lyubov Yakimchuk, in the foreword to her recent book, Apricots of Donbass, has written about the intrusion of war into the language. The shells of the words remain the same, but the new senses appear. For Skugareva, a similar epiphany occurred after the 11th of July attack on Zelenopilia in 2014, which was the first documented rocket barrage launched from the Russian territory that killed and wounded a great number of Ukrainian soldiers. The next day, Skugareva went to a local market, bought a bouquet, and made what she calls my first still life, which she titled 12th of July to commemorate the date. Contrasted against the foil of the dark background, the brightly colored flowers appear solemn, yet there is no festive triumph or joyfulness in them. Only after beginning her still life, Skugareva noticed the poppy flowers were included in the bouquet. An unusual choice because this flower is rarely included because it fades very fast. And but for her, it added the additional layer of meaning since immediately all this song laments came into her mind. Ukrainian folks, so for instance, «Покотилась головочка так, як маківочка, вилетіла з душа стіла, як листівочка». The head rolled down as a poppy flower. The soul has left the body as a martin bird. Finally, Skugareva felt that traditional media was not failing her, but adapting to include these new conditions, and thus was able to paint another still life on July 16th. Initially, she wanted the background to be lemon yellow, but she covered it with dark brown when on the next day, Malaysia Airlines flight was shot down above Hrabove village in Donetsk region. Only recognizable as war imagery via the artist's commentary, Skugareva's exquisite still lives are still inevitably and fatally reframed by the war, whose invisible marks are impossible to erase from their surfaces. The dismemberment and fragmentation of a body, embodying the inner torment of personality induced by the repressive mechanism of the human psyche and symbolic order, are common concerns for Vlad Ralko. However, since the war in the Donbas, this visceral brutality and agony of fractured and mutating bodies attained a special poignancy in Ralko's paintings and drawings. Acutely perceptive toward trauma and its manifestations. Initially documenting the events of Maidan, Ralko's Kyiv diary series evolved to also include her reaction to the annexation of Crimea and the Donbas war. The human body pushed through the slot of a voting booth becomes a discomforting heap of a minced meat to allude to the so-called referendums in Crimea and Donbas and the repugnant violence that followed. On another page of the diary, we see Mars and Venus exchanging places, the mellow passivity of the former contrasted to the anxious vigilance of the latter, with war explosions in the background. According to the artist, the war is turning everything inside out, uncovering the intestines and the obscene layer of reality, bringing the previously invisible to the fore and making the most macabre metaphor incarnate. The mundane and ordinary architecture of the Soviet era is no longer neutrally anonymous, but suddenly speaks volumes about the past. The fragmented body on Ralko's painting, formally testifying to the inner war of hidden desires and dramas, now becomes disturbingly real. In her own words, the war attacks the body from the outside, wounds it, marks, amputates. The image of the cocoon is a transformation of the old torso motif in Ralko's art, now protectively covered with textile, like the body of the saint on the icon of the Dormition scene, or swaddled like that of a helpless infant thrown into the world. One of the most ravaging effects war has, in Ralko's opinion, is on female subjectivity, questioning its core and reducing it to hollowed out symbols like the Soviet motherland requiring the ultimate sacrifice from its children. The artist revisits the symbols herself, disturbing the war narratives by including a character inspired by Ukrainian folk ragdoll, Lyalka Motanka, which traditionally served as a protective charm. In Ralko's painting, and this oversized and ghoulish version of the textile doll endures Christ-like passions, her newly found corporeal vulnerability, refusing to be contained within the symbolic order. I'm going to conclusion. Ralko does not allow for woman to play the passive and depersonalized victim in a gory and exciting spectacle, acknowledging the damage that woman is subjected to by war, not started by her. Ralko strategically omits a glorified and victorious depiction of fighting men, which would present war, in Zontag words, as a dignified all-male group outing. The failure and inefficiency of realistic visuality appears as one of the overarching themes uniting the artistic responses to the Donbas war that I discussed today. Also pervasive is the empathy towards suffering and a highly personal, emotional, and in some cases autobiographical involvement. Often touching upon extreme circumstances, this art communicates tolerance both in terms of endurance or survivability and in the need of delicateness, often inherent to devoted gardeners when dealing with those affected by war. Neither making spectacle from the pain of the others nor deeming it unrepresentable, this art posits empathic and conceptual alternatives to traditional war narratives. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your very interesting presentation.